In a week's time, the dome is due to close after a very difficult year. It's a sad end for a dream agreed by New Labour shortly after they were elected.
This is our chance to make a statement of faith in our capacity in Britain to do this bigger and better than anyone else.
The dream quickly became embroiled in politics, press attacks, a race against the clock to build it, and to fill it with something meaningful.
The Millennium Dome is a success. It will never be forgotten. If it's a failure, we will never be forgiven.
Outrageous. It's crap.
Now we follow the story on from the disastrous opening night that is marred by huge queues.
It's a disgrace. That's what it is.
Happy New Year.
Through the difficult first weeks running Britain's biggest visitor attraction.
I regret that nobody had a crystal ball which could foresee the unforeseeable.
And on through the year, as money runs out, almost everyone involved leaves, and designers who created the zones inside despair.
It's just gradually become like a nightmare. You know, now I think we're going to hear of more things that we weren't even aware of.
What went wrong and why? It's the afternoon of New Year's Eve and the dream is about to unravel. Tonight, the dome is being unveiled to the world. For dome boss Jenny Page and her team, everything now depends on the verdict of press and public.
Well, there's not a great deal that I personally can do any longer other than keeping on walking around the place, making sure that the last details are handled.
Jenny Page finds something ominous by her in-tray, a present from one of her suppliers.
It just materialised overnight. I decided it was probably just about the right size to go over a rather sort of neat little plastic urn with my ashes in it, and that what it was trying to tell me was that it was a tombstone.
Do you think you're going to get burnt up then after this?
No.
Or drop dead tomorrow?
I should just find another job.
Jenny's team has only just made it. The centrepiece body zone was only finished today.
I'm here early to check the show to make sure it actually works.
John Hackney has designed the show inside the body.
I'm terrified. My biggest fear about all these things is that during this week they've been slipping in and out of sync. And they make no sense whatsoever. So far it's in sync. Relief.
Proud of your dad.
Yeah.
It's quite special to be here tonight, isn't
yeah.
it? It's a big privilege, isn't it?
Yeah.
Ken, how are we doing?
Ken Robinson is Jenny's director of operations.
Everybody's now back out and on the last stage of cleaning, last stage of setting. Everything's ready.
Yes.
Just waiting for them to come through the gates.
At 6 p.m, the first of the 10,000 specially invited guests arrive to look around the zones. For the designers of the play zone, it's an exciting moment.
Kids' room looks fantastic.
Peter Higgins and Shirley Walker have brought their six-week-old baby Louis along. They have spent over 2 years struggling to please sponsors, ministers, and Jenny Page.
It's fantastic. There's a little girl playing the piano.
People like it.
Derek Tuke Hastings has been working flat out to prevent his flying creatures crashing into his home planet zone.
Look, it's just having a little look at us now. I'm delighted, absolutely thrilled.
With the eyes of the world on the biggest tent on Earth, security is tight, but Jenny Page has a plan. Politicians and their entourage will come from Westminster by tube. Other guests will have to get to East London to check in before travelling on. Due to an administrative error, thousands of tickets haven't been sent out on time. They require tight security too.
If they haven't got the tickets are waiting for them at the railway stations. So Liam and Sarah are at Stratford and Charlton, and we've got senior management on the site there to make sure that everything goes well.
Everybody here has been planning this for so long. We live it, we've dreamed it, we've practiced it. We hope for everyone, you know, it's everybody's this. And tonight's the best night.
Well, here's to all of us.
I always remember Jenny saying on New Year's Eve, saying, right, well, we've done that, and now we've got to run it. And I said, you're too late. You know, we should have worked out how to do that a long time ago. And she knew that too. We'd run out of time.
Time has run out at Stratford, where things are going horribly wrong. The queues are getting longer. Guests include newspaper editors and sponsors.
An awful lot of sponsors, Boots included. We had a party of about 130 people. The vast majority of those were ordinary members of staff to come with their families and have a very special night out. And nothing that we could have said in advance could have prepared them for this.
The first hour was okay. The second hour got fairly grim. And by the third hour, I think people were getting quite desperate. Because, I mean, at one stage it looked as though nobody was going to get there before midnight. And the thought of celebrating the millennium at Stratford Tube Station didn't really appeal.
This is what it's all about. Total incompetence.
And so just tell us about this, how do you feel about it?
We've got no tickets, we've been standing out there for an hour and a half, being bloody crushed. It's a disgrace. That's what it is.
Nobody really knew what was going on. The announcements were completely unhelpful. We then had to go through this security check. There was just one scanner, and so of course it was immensely time consuming.
Stupid bloody fiasco this is.
At 9 p.m. the Prime Minister arrives. His tube ride from Westminster works faultlessly.
The quality is in the detail in the dome.
Right.
I became aware of Greg Dyke using fantastically colourful language. I gather later he could be found running around the Millennium Dome trying to find Peter Mandelson to do who knows what mischief.
One person who can be really, really, really proud of what she and her team have achieved is standing right behind you.
Hello. Jenny Page, the Chief Executive. Welcome to the Dome.
He's going
to
have a party.
It was a nightmare for all the people who supposedly were getting a reward for good public service, for being leading members of their community. You know, by the time they got there, most of them, zones had all shut down. Some of them couldn't even get a glass of champagne. Well, I couldn't, for what it's worth. You know, it was a scandal. And I also felt, as a journalist, well, this is a very good story.
Coded bomb warning is received, but with such tight security, they decide celebrations can continue.
How'd you feel? Did you think we'd make it?
No, I didn't.
By midnight, all 10,000 guests have joined the Queen, the Prime Minister, and Lord Faulkner, the Dome Minister. The dream of making Britain centre stage for the year 2000 is about to begin.
What a marvellous success it was. It all went incredibly well. As long as you didn't come from Stratford, it was fine. It was a great success. It was a fantastic evening.
It was wonderful to see these floods of people coming in, looking really happy.
Yeah. It was absolutely brilliant, the whole thing.
Incidentally, on the day afterwards, I had a call from Lord Faulkner in the office, apologising to me for what I had gone through. I said, you know, it was very kind of him to ring, and I appreciated it. But the fact was that he couldn't apologise or hadn't apologised to all the people, the thousands of people who'd been inconvenienced. And, you know, I had to write about that.
It should never have taken as long as it did at Stratford, and I really apologise to all the people, VIPs and everybody else alike, who did suffer at Stratford. It was really awful, but it was very much a one-off.
It all depends who you've upset. And there was no doubt about it that there were some people who were very upset who could also then retaliate, which they did.
I think the dome was sent as a gift from God, really, so that cartoonists' job would be easier. He's become almost the most kind of famous or notorious image in Britain, and a sort of byword for failure and hubris.
Right from the start, the dome has had many critics. The whole project was going to cost £750 million to be funded by a mixture of lottery money and business sponsors. But ticket sales would be vital to break even. There were to be 14 different exhibition zones in a ring, answering the big questions of who we are, what we do, and where we live. But before their contents had even been decided, Jenny Page and her NMEC team made the fatal error of basing their whole business plan on attracting 12 million visitors, despite the man looking after the lottery money not being so sure.
I advised the commission that they should plan on the basis of 8 million, but they accepted NMEC's business plan that they could achieve 12 million. They'd seen what was being achieved in the rest of the world, and they thought 12 million, because we were told it was achievable, should be the target which they went for.
I think 12 million was the correct judgment to make based on all the most accurate market research and expectations of the time.
As 2000 begins, everything now depends on winning over the press and public and attracting those 12 million visitors. Despite slower than expected advance sales, the Minister for the Dome is still optimistic on day one.
Today is a sellout, tomorrow's a sellout. We've sold well over a million tickets. We've got a target of 12 million. All the response that we've been having indicates we're going to meet that target and probably exceed it.
But the expected visitors will be using an almost untested dome. Everything has been running so late that Jenny Page's operations director, Ken Robinson, hasn't had the months of trials necessary.
Ken's team are going to be going through their paces for the first week or 10 days while it all beds down. And I'm sure they'll do brilliantly, but they've got to get used to running the place.
Whenever you rush, you then normally make mistakes. There was meant to be at least a month where people would come in, try it out, see how it worked. That would have been a lifesaver for Ken and his team.
My task wasn't the creative aspects of choosing the themes or dealing with the designers, except on practical matters. But it was absolutely everything to do with visitors and how visitors would experience the dome.
3 days after the Millennium Dome opened to the public, visitors are still facing huge delays and long queues to get inside.
This is the body zone inside the dome, and there is, of course, a queue for it. It snakes away just out of sight beneath the torso, and then it comes to the foot of this staircase. You might think that's it, but actually, no. The queue continues over the bridge and then round this spiral and away there into the distance in front of the money zone.
It has queues of up to 2 hours. Sponsors have paid £12 million towards a single zone, and Boots expects good publicity.
We were particularly concerned about the reports of long queues to get into the body. And it was very important to stand up for those people who were queuing up.
The length of queues at the Dome are negligible by theme park or expo standards. The exception was the body. The fact that the body was an exception was because what was in it was not designed to meet the visitor flow that it had to actually achieve.
Adman John Hackney was responsible for the inside of the body. The dome centrepiece had been through many redesigns, and he was asked to rescue it at the last minute.
I turned the job down to begin with. Then every big hitter in the world called me, you know, Alan Yentob, Michael Grade, Lord Faulkner. It was like major pressure. They just turned up the heat. Like, you cannot believe. In a couple of days, my phone was melting with all these big names.
He's had just 20 weeks up to New Year's Eve to design and build his exhibits of hearts and eyes and squash them into the vast pink-tiled body, using his wide experience from major movies to ads like a cigar called Hamlet.
I love this car.
The body was the last thing to be finished. It was the most obvious. Everybody could understand it. It was an icon of what was going to be in the dome. And when everybody arrived, they went straight to it to go into it. And the fact that the displays within it were inappropriately defined, and therefore people couldn't get through it, and everyone wanted to get through it, created unmanageable queues.
The queues go on forever for my zone. So I kind of have to park all the other nonsense to one side. I delivered. It's a shame that the rub-off reversing into me isn't better.
It's obvious, you know, supermarket psychology that you don't put the thing that everybody wants at the entrance.
Sure.
And
so
this happened.
They got the big queues at the body.
Yeah.
Designers like Peter Higgins and Shirley Walker of the Play Zone have spent years with Ken Robinson telling them how to get the 12 million expected visitors round their zones.
I believe he worked at Bewley Motor Museum, where he was dealing with probably, you know, as many people that passed through the dome gates in 5 minutes would have passed through his museum in a day. So where was that experience?
Well, of course, nobody's ever built a dome before, but I've spent all of my life working in visitor attractions, which is a very particular field.
Working with Ken was very amusing. Because he was Mr. Solution, and he was caught on the hop. He was caught on the hop on Jam One, when suddenly there were all these queues, and he must have felt quite uncomfortable, because I remember him saying many times, there will never be any queues at the dome.
You were selected for your talent at being able to produce a solution that will meet the brief, and I have every reason to believe that at the end of this long and tortuous exercise, you will do that.
Unfortunately, he was then proved to be right on the bad days. There were no queues at the dome on the bad days because hardly anyone was there. So for Ken, it was a tough one.
A week in, Boots is very upset.
One of the sponsors of the Millennium Dome hasn't yet paid its whack. Boots, who were expected to stump up for the body zone, say they're unhappy with the queues.
Ken Robinson now comes up with time tickets for visiting the body.
Measures were taken within a week. The queues started to disappear, and all the feedback that we have now on a daily basis is people are not queuing for more than 20, 25 minutes to get into the body, and that's acceptable in our view.
It's not just queues that are the problem. Visitor attractions need the time for proper trials to get the equipment working right too.
In the beach area where there was the arcade, a lot of things were out of order.
Now it's having all its teething problems in public. John Hackney is almost having a heart attack.
Well, I mean, there were certainly problems with people knowing how to turn it on in the morning. Can you believe it? How to turn on every single aspect of the body. I would find out that the heart wasn't pumping. Or that hero Tommy Cooper brain wasn't working. I delivered a show that worked. So I can put my hand on my heart and say, I know that we put enough thought into these processes that are gonna have to go on week after week to know that the thing is durable and it's gonna go on and on working, which is all I can do. If they then take that show and then not turn on various aspects of it, or not make certain things function.
Is it connected to Jenny's heart at the moment?
I have to be philosophical about that.
There were teething problems, and the teething problems occurred at a time when contractors all went on holiday. So actually trying to get the contractors to come back to repair things was very difficult. And so those things which were minor in the context of 23 acres and a very complicated show and a massive day out, those few things gave yet another reason for the press to recall them. Oh, we've found six things wrong today.
But there's a far bigger problem now. Not enough people are coming. Criticism is mounting on the whole experience and what is inside the dome. This vast New Labour project has been through many hands. It started off in 1997 with Peter Mandelson as minister and a design consultant, Stephen Bailey.
The whole culture, its sense, its style, its belief system wasn't as a big, outgoing, educational, artistic, you know, communications project. It was, you know, it was construed as a little branch of the civil service, and the press was, the press was something to be manipulated and strangulated. Sponsors were something to be take money from. The whole feeling and culture was not outgoing and positive.
I think he called himself the creative director of it. He was no such thing. He was just a person with very, very loud opinions, but very few ideas. He walked, you see, from it. I mean, he walked before he was pushed.
Peter Mandelson searched high and low for his creative director.
You know, I kept coming back to this and revisiting this issue time and time again, much to Jenny's impatience, I remember, because, you know, she kept on saying to me, look, if we could find somebody who really fitted the bill, you know, we'd appoint them. So who do you have in mind? And then I'd think, oh, crikey, I can't think of anyone. And then I would come back again with two or three names, you know, a month later, and she would sort of pick them off one after another and say, no, that person's not suitable, or this person's not going to fit in, or whatever. And then I would come back again, you know, with another suggestion, and she said, by this time she was saying, well, it's really too late.
In the end, they were left with their young, inexperienced team of content editors to supervise the designers.
I think it will go above 95 out of 100 visitors' heads. They just won't get it. They
but
will
then
not
it's
understand
which work progress, on for Christ's sake.
There's huge practical constraints and difficulties.
Well, those are what we should be talking about. But you're shifting your ground. So the real question is actually having a clear view as to whether there is quality.
With a background in the civil service and no creative director, Jenny Page assembled the Litmus Group. It was an occasional committee of the great and good, including museum directors and TV bosses. Designers also had to present their ideas to this.
It's still not clear to me what your proposition is.
What the Litmus Group is saying to you is, this is form without function, frankly.
You can't have one vision with a group of people. So I don't think you could ever replace a creative director with a committee.
No.
People couldn't make up their minds. People didn't want to take decisions, take responsibility. And it just kept on going round and round in circles. I mean, that's why the dome is round. So people would just go round and round. In a square building, maybe people would knock in the walls and made a decision.
With the dome content not catching fire with the British public, by late January, the dome's fate seems sealed. Visitor figures are half what is expected.
Louis, look, there's the journey zone. Here it is, look, this is Gary's journey zone.
I'll tell you what we're missing.
It's Mr. Robinson.
He's just come to check the numbers, to see whether we can actually get the numbers in.
They were always fooling themselves about the revenue they were going to push through. Well, it wasted time and energy, and ultimately it cost the NMEC money, I think.
They don't know what they're doing, these people.
You know, because we were designing buildings to take means of escape, for instance. You know, everything had to be designed to these phenomenal numbers that were never achievable.
Why is that fair?
Well, because it's complicated and it's a very clever piece of engineering.
There's Lord Falconer. He's in charge.
Yeah, but Peter, who's that?
There's Mr. Mandelson. He does pop up every now and then. What do you think of the dome?
Not only are they losing money from lower ticket sales, more irate sponsors from McDonald's to Tesco are refusing to pay up too.
You know, it was a difficult situation all round, but those were the reasons why the dome did not have money to pay its bills and ran short of money in January of 2000.
Well, the financial management, from our point of view, was appalling. It started off with fantastic intentions, and we had a good contract. And we had things called milestone payments, which all agreed to the design, to everything. That was wonderful. And I thought, this is terrific. This is really going to work. And then no money appears. I mean, that's appalling. That is the biggest sign to me that we've got a cash flow problem.
As well as sponsors and money from tickets, Jenny Page has received £450 million of lottery money from the Millennium Commission. Now, as January draws to a close, they're the only people she can turn to for more if she's to pay her bills. And its boss, Mike O'Connor.
The financial problems started to emerge at the back end of 1999 when the advance ticket sales were not which we hoped. But the real hard evidence didn't come until January, when the number of visitors in January wasn't what we had hoped. So we got an application at the end of January for an extra £60 million.
But they want changes.
We were keen to see more management skill being brought in, skill that we thought was needed in terms of the operational experience.
It needed to be more actively involved and providing more leadership in the project. And my chairman, Chris Smith, wrote to Lord Faulkner to make these points.
Unknown to Jenny Page, chairman of the Dome Company, Bob Ayling, has been searching out someone to help her. Now he comes up with a young Frenchman with experience of Euro Disney and invites him to visit the Dome on the 3rd of February.
Bob Ayling called on the Thursday, and I'm like, well, met with Bob in Heathrow the next morning, 2 hours discussion, and I said, you know, it's not for me, honestly. And he still convinced me to say, well, you know, fine, you don't want it, but why don't you go there, check it for yourself? And I went there, and I was really hooked. And I think, you know, I can help. I really can help and be have an impact.
The next day, the figures for January's visitors are announced. Jenny Page has got the extra money, but at the highest personal cost.
Jenny Page, the chief executive of the company which runs the Millennium Dome, has resigned. The news comes after the publication yesterday of disappointing attendance figures.
I had some conversations with her at the time. She accepted the situation and she left. I think she handled it very well.
I was really shocked, horrified, staggered. I thought if she made it to the end of January, she'd made it. I thought she'd got through all the major gunfire.
You could sense that people were looking for someone to take the fall. And normally, the higher up the person, the more satisfactory it is for those who are criticizing. And she herself, Jenny herself, said, I cannot necessarily see myself getting all the way through this. I've worked with government before.
Now P.Y. Jabot is in sole charge. With the extra £60 million, they recalculate visitor figures and come up with a new estimate of £10 million to break even. To win them, Jabot, known as PY, brings in his own brand of joie de vivre.
I think it has nothing to do with the Disney theme park, apart maybe from the magic it brings. But I mean, this is a totally different product. I think this is, for me, a fantastic achievement. And for me, it is what the 21st century has to offer.
This project needs somebody who had run a major international visitor attraction, who had a track record of fixing things. They found that guy in P.Y. Jabot. He's an incredibly energetic, dedicated, hands-on, knowledgeable guy.
Can you go down a little bit?
Yeah, there'll be no going down at this show.
Bonjour, bonjour.
How are you doing?
How are you?
Yep.
Good? Go for a walk?
Yep.
Bonjour, mum.
PY immediately brings in his own operations man to work alongside Hi. Ken Robinson.
Oh, she's giving me my schedule for today.
So this is Arnaud Palu, another ugly Frenchman. Actually, Arnaud had the unpleasure to work with me for 10 years in Disney. So he knows how I think and he's been running the operation. It's been working very well.
He told me that he had his own person that he wished to bring in reporting to him in carrying out the duties that I and others have been doing. So that was quite clear.
3 weekends.
They quickly tackle the remaining queue.
We've changed the flow, the visitor flow. So main entrance, the people were going directly to the dome. So that means you got the bulk of the people really moving in and dumping on the body. So we diverted the flow and gave the opportunity to sponsors, our partners, to show what they were doing.
So actually by directing people through the sponsors' village, taking this opportunity, it was a way also to try to slow the flow down.
In 1 month, the queue line came from, you know, an average 25 minutes to 5 minutes, and the buddy. So that was spectacular.
That wonderful project should have continued with the same team. I'm not saying it did any harm for PY to come in and to take over the operations of the dome. He has tried his best, and I'm sure he's done a good job. But it wasn't necessary for that change to be made.
Ken Robinson is next to go, still convinced that it could have worked.
The business plan that was accepted was the business plan that the board submitted to the commission and that the commission decided to agree. And the dome that was going to be created certainly justified the expectations that the market research had supported.
Soon, P.Y. Jabot's honeymoon ends. The press is on the attack again.
I mean, he's clearly not the guy that he was sold us on day one. I mean, the notion that he was the kind of saviour of Euro Disney or the senior this or the senior that appears not to be true. You know, all this sort of new Labour spinning, I mean, it was they were desperate to find someone, and it was all a bit too convenient that this guy seemed suddenly to be ready, have no job, and could start work on the next Monday. And I think his career wasn't the career that we were first told.
His first experience of the British press is nearly his last.
I didn't nearly resign and nearly gone in the next Eurostar. It's just the atmosphere around this is so different. You know, I was hard to run a visitor attraction, which I have the skills to do.
PY fights back. He discounts tickets, starts selling them on the door, and adds lots of fun.
One more time. Be there.
And the February numbers begin to rise.
Hello. Uh-oh.
And is this your first visit?
Yeah.
Right, and you like it?
Yeah.
What have you seen?
Not much.
None to what you've been doing.
Lord Faulkner decided they should give more than 1 million free tickets to school trips. But the children may not revisit with their parents, who would have to pay.
Waffle Tour is excellent, and I liked the part when we went into the islands part because the people in there was very nice.
And it showed you the heart, and it's beating really fast, and it was like scary and horrible.
Some rides, that would have topped it.
Would you like to come back?
No, not particularly.
Have you got our team?
Derek Tuke Hastings is one grown-up who comes back again and again to check on his zone. Yeah. Originally, he had 3 rides planned, including a ghost train and a giant floating waterbed. But he was only allowed to do 1 of them, a ride through planet Earth.
Powerful forces at work here. Volcanoes are like safety valves in the planet's crust. We're descending deep within the planet.
What did you think of that?
That's brilliant.
Did you enjoy it?
Oh, yes.
Do you like it?
Yes.
The volcano.
Yeah? Did you enjoy it, sir?
Very interesting.
What did you find interesting about it?
Well, it was sort of life of the planet, you know, as it is.
He designed it.
Did he? Congratulations. Well done.
My team over there designed it.
Well done.
Surveys show high appreciation from those who do come, and Home Planet is one of the most popular zones. But the whole thing is a bit disconnected, and some zones aren't fun or clear enough. For Derek, even the Millennium Show in the Central Arena is a bit difficult to grasp.
We bought the book. We bought the book, and it explains the whole thing. But for the majority of people, it's just a nice thing to watch. But if you actually know what it's about, it's even better. It's all about the Earth people meeting the Sky people. I reckon they could have explained that in the title of the show.
Well, you know, obviously I wasn't there at the time, so I cannot, you know, say what happened or what went wrong. What I think is a creative leadership was lacking by the fact that the dome doesn't tell you a story.
What's happened here? A little bit blancmange, lots of stuff in, a little bit of political correctness and things like that have crept in. I mean, I feel such disappointment and frustration.
Despite Gerbeau's efforts, in the all-important Easter holidays, the new lower visitor target is missed. Cash is running out again. In May, Mike O'Connor is given another call asking for more lottery money.
I took the view that another £29 million didn't represent value for money, because the number of extra visitors it would buy, in my view, was quite small. That meant that if they had heeded my advice, the dome would have had to close.
The largest tent in the world is now insolvent and threatened with closure, and some designers still haven't been fully paid.
It was ridiculous. If all our clients were like them, we wouldn't be in business. And if we're meant to be celebrating British creativity, don't put them into receivership at the same time. That is no celebration.
Peter Mandelson has given but the Millennium Commissioners, including Michael Heseltine, have made promises and can't let the dome go bankrupt.
Well, we were obviously very disappointed. We had agreed budgets and they weren't sufficient in the circumstances. But faced with the choice, there was no alternative but for the Millennium Commission to stand behind the project, which was so associated with our own initial decisions. And towards the end, actually, the choice came to either letting the creditors carry the strain or honouring the implications of our initial support. And I have no doubt at all that the Millennium Commission were right to take those decisions. Equally, of course, I was the minister that had negotiated the fact that the Millennium Commission in the end would have its life extended in order to make any deficits up that emerged. We didn't think there would be any, but I had given those commitments on behalf of the government.
The Millennium Dome was handed a £29 million lottery lifeline today. It's also admitted it won't attract nearly as many visitors this year as had previously been expected.
Will you need more money?
No, I got that grant on the table. That's exactly what we're going to need, and this is it.
So categorically no, you're not going to ask for any more money?
No, I'm categorically saying we're not going to go for more.
This time, the Dome's chairman, who was responsible for Jenny Page going, falls on the sword. Bob Ayling of British Airways has lost his second job this year. With more funds, the dome lives on. PY decides to launch a new marketing attack to cash in on the summer, and an ad making fun of the doubters.
And another thing, that dome.
What's the point of that then, eh? Blooming great marquee. Wouldn't waste me time going. Apparently, I've heard...
He brings in a fair around the outside, but the year 2000 has one of the wettest summers on record. Visitors stay away. But things are hotting up in the political arena.
The contents of the dome stand as a monument to the vanity and the emptiness of New Labour. Madam Speaker, first they blamed the chief executive and they sacked her, then they blamed the chairman and they sacked him. Isn't it time someone in this government had the courage to stand up and take responsibility and then resign?
There are calls for Lord Faulkner to go.
It's just politics don't match with business, as simple as it is, and it's just been there from day one.
Back before the dome's opening, the designers found that even when they had passed Jenny Page's content editors and litmus group, the minister might want his say as well.
In fact, you make a light show which dominates your
space. It's not a game as such.
It's almost like a pianola. It strikes the keys and then sends a shard of light up into the air.
It is too museum-y type play rather than play type play. It's play. It's intended to be for children. Mm. Is it not?
One has to question the team that she'd built around her was suspect. And I don't know how that was imposed upon her, or we'll never know that. And we don't know, you know, how much of the political messaging was imposed upon her. One felt that she was uncomfortable, certainly, with that.
In June, Jenny Page is called before the Select Committee and has the chance to get her own back.
Did you try to get them to keep right out of it altogether?
I made several personal attempts to persuade ministers that standing back from the dome would be good for them as well as good for the dome.
that the dome was always going to be quite legitimately an important political issue, and ministers have always got to be in a position to be properly accountable to Parliament for what's going on. Them being involved to that extent is an entirely different matter from them making day-to-day decisions about what happened at the dome and what went on inside the dome. We didn't. That was a matter for the people running the dome at the company. But the political focus has always been on ministers. The problem has therefore been, because you focus always on the ministers for political accountability, you assume that they are running on a day-to-day basis the dome. They are not. And they never have been.
In July, there's some good news. The government finds a buyer for the dome at the end of the year, but they need someone to get the books in order. Britain's number one company doctor, more used to international rescues, David James, receives a call.
It was the first day of what was supposed to be a week's holiday, intended because I was going on to Goodwood for the rest of the week, and the phone rang. Interesting call. You never quite know when your life's going to get changed by one phone call coming out of the blue, do you? Mobile phones are not good for you.
The buyer is Nomura, the Japanese bank. They want to keep a jazzed-up dome open next year. PY has been able to get another £43 million from the Lottery Commission, promising the Nomura money will pay it back. But James finds an unexpected financial hole. They'll need another £47 million to close the dome, on top of the £43 million to keep it going.
And then the 5th of September was very much a critical day, because the NMEC board had been given very strong advice by a licensed insolvency practitioner that if the commission did not put the money up that day, they had to close that night, and it was as dramatic as that. And what they said was that they were prepared to put the 47 million up, but it was absolutely interconditional upon me accepting the job of chairman. And so I had 20 minutes to digest that and terms on which I would take the job.
Because people said, well, you're asking for money, you said you would never go back. Well, are you going to resign? What have you done wrong? How come you're spending 47 more?
I think there was a sense of disbelief each time they went back for more money, just because the assurances had been so solid that they would never, ever, ever ask for more money again. So it did actually draw gasps from the newsroom.
The opposition leader, William Hague, called it a farce, an endless black hole, an empty, pointless tent.
He should fire the dome minister.
30,000 jobs, £1 billion worth of tourism are benefits that are still obtainable and worth fighting for. I therefore intend to stay with the project.
You're not going to resign?
I'm not going to resign.
Faulkner stays on, but Nomura, worried by the money and the political flack, pull out. It's a big blow for Derek Tuke Hastings. Nomura were planning to keep his home Planet Zone in their dome and build some of his other rides.
Well, I must admit, I mean, I was desperately disappointed when I heard that the Dome Europe thing wasn't happening, because obviously for us it was a fantastic opportunity to kind of take on from where we were before. So that was a real shame, to say the least. But I can understand why they didn't take it on. I mean, it is damned, it's damned.
Then something happened. Something miraculous.
Derek is still in the line of creditors.
We negotiated for as long as we possibly could. But there comes a time when you say, I will now take my money and leave the table. So it was better to settle. And it was a reasonable settlement. I mean, it wasn't a disaster, but it certainly wasn't as much as I would have liked, obviously. Even when they settled, they didn't pay us because they didn't get any money. And then they said, which was very good, the people who are there now said, you will be paid so much in such and such time and the rest such and such time, and they have actually fulfilled it. But boy, oh boy, talk about blood out of a stone.
It's November, and Dome baby Louis is 1 year old. Peter and Shirley are going for a night out. Their play zone has been nominated for the best entertainment venue in the world.
You know, it's like saying that you designed the cranes for the lifeboat on the Titanic. That's what, you know, really.
That's why we can't win. Have a little cheer when they mention it.
Oh, yeah, but do you think people might laugh? People might actually.
We might get a boo.
I know.
That'll be awful.
I know.
If we do now, you've made me nervous. I'm not looking forward to it now.
Disaster keeps rolling on, you know, this fact that they've had to keep going back for more and more money. And you just think, how can this happen? And then you just backtrack and you say, well, if these are the same people that were doing the original business plan, then that shows the incompetence right the way through the whole project. There was never, ever the bigger picture.
They're up against an Italian cinema and a theatre in the prestigious FX International Design Awards.
Tension building.
Right, the winner is... Play Zone, Millennium Dome.
Please come to the stage, Peter Higgins, Robert Dwarf, Sterling Walker and James Dibble from Land. Well done. The judges call this out on the quality of imagination, Jeff, sadly rarely found in the dome.
Hopefully this will make some of the critics stop and just go back and have a look and see if there is anything at all worth complimenting.
Can you give me one of those? All right.
It's nearly Christmas. Only half the estimated 12 million people have visited the dome, including the free schoolchildren.
Thank you very much.
People say, why has the dome failed? But there's one thing which has failed with the dome, and one thing only, and that is that it has shortfallen by 6 million people against the expectation. If you'd had the other 6 million and they'd come in and paid the revenue that was needed, this would have been seen as a brilliant success.
The designers come down for their last look at the dome. There is still no buyer, although the government is negotiating with Legacy, who plan to immediately rip out all their zones and turn the dome into a business centre. PY now introduces his own personal passion in a final effort to attract Christmas crowds, an ice rink.
I think I have to be a very strong ambassador and fight for it. And it is regarded outside Britain for the most fantastic innovation. And it's all overshadowed and hidden behind all these political agendas and really nasty news about 3 years ago they had the wrong business plan.
We will meet all the targets in the present business plan. Indeed, the present business plan is based on, I think, between 4.5 and 4.6 revenue-generating visitors. And we're now 2 weeks to go. We've already met that target.
Attack!
You know, I've heard politicians say, oh, it was overambitious, we should never have done it.
Did you see the triple turn around the back? I did it around the back.
It wasn't overambitious, it was achievable. If the right people had been involved, it was easily achievable.
Yes. I'm depressed. All that kind of effort and creativity and angst.
Where are the good and the great now?
Yeah.
Nowhere to be seen at all.
People
they all
do
disappeared
like it,
up their little rabbit
Eric,
holes.
People do like it. Therefore, if the press hadn't
could have been
so
much
negative,
yeah.
It could have been more successful.
Well, you know and I know, it could have been 10 times better.
Everything's reduced.
We've got to get one of these.
What's that?
Well, it's a dome tin with shortcake in. And these, I think we should have some of these.
No, these are my favourite. They've got E271 in them.
They've got so much.
You felt like they were going to get something like 12 million visitors, didn't you?
If they'd said 5, and then they got 6, everyone would have gone, brilliant.
Yeah, but the arithmetic wouldn't have been so bad if we didn't have to redesign 4 times.
Legacy, if they pay what they say they're going to pay for this place, they are getting it for nothing.
But all they're going to do eventually is knock it down and stick up some developer's architecture.
Yeah,
aren't they?
Absolutely. It will be.
And this lovely structure.
Legacy haven't got it yet, have they?
That's true.
That is
true.
Haven't
got it yet.
No. That is true.
I think it has been very damaging, actually, that it has somehow helped to destroy the idea of Cool Britannia, because the Prime Minister himself identified very, very strongly with it.
And in the sense that people criticised it for being empty and vacuous, and to the extent that people think that's true of New Labour, I think it did become a kind of symbol of New Labour.
Now, it's not been the success we hoped, that is true, and there's no point in denying that. However, I don't apologise for trying to do something really ambitious for the Millennium.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye, Dome. Yes, bye-bye.
Last Tuesday, at the end of a long, hard year for the Dome, the Prime Minister came down to pay his final respects. The dream is over.
Never mind. Hope you have a nice time. Good to see you. Bye-bye.